imagine something for me. If you were to pick the top must-see attractions for visitors coming to Yellowstone, what would they be? I'm going to say you're considering things like seeing an eruption of Old Faithful, watching wildlife in Lamar Valley, or walking around the enormous rim of Grand Prismatic. Something along those lines, am I right? Okay, now how many visitors do you think would rank seeing tiny microscopic organisms thriving in the park's hydrothermal features as a must-see attraction? Probably not many. A visitor might love seeing the rainbow-colored waters, but I doubt their interests are focused on the trillions of microbial cells that come together to form that beautiful colored mat. Well, my name is Dr. Dana Skorupa, and I think about hot spring microorganisms a lot. As a thermal biologist at Montana State University, I spend my time trying to figure out ways to harness the cellular machinery inside hot spring microorganisms and use them in commercial industries which must operate at extreme conditions. You might be asking yourself, are hot springs really a good place to look for microorganisms with beneficial uses? My answer to that question would be an emphatic yes, and here's why. If we count the number of different macrofauna species in Yellowstone, that being any organism we can see with our naked eye, it would total around 2,000 different species. Now let's compare that to the number of different microbial species in just one hot spring. Here we can see there's over 5,000 different species. And that's just one spring. Park-wide, Yellowstone is home to over 14,000 geothermal features. This means high-temperature habitats are the true source of Yellowstone's biological diversity, and they give us a much higher chance of finding organisms with cool commercial applications. Okay, I want to switch gears for just a minute and talk trash. Humans are producing enormous amounts of plastic trash, most of which nature can't digest. To date, humans have produced over 300 million tons of plastic waste, and of that, only 8% is annually recycled. Plastics are notoriously difficult to break down. It can take an agonizing 1,000 years for a single plastic water bottle to biodegrade. However, back in 2016, a team of microbiologists made a significant breakthrough. They isolated a bacteria from a plastic recycling facility that could literally eat plastic as its food. Sounds cool, right? Problem solved. We'll use this new microbe to recycle plastics. Well, it's not quite that easy. See, it's actually the enzyme that's made and produced and excreted by this organism, which gives it the ability to eat plastic. In order for the recycling industry to use this enzyme, it must be able to function at temperatures where the plastic begins to soften. This softened state is where the enzyme can really burrow into the material and effectively break it down. The rub is, many plastics don't begin to soften until they reach high temperatures, say on the order of 140 to 170 degrees Fahrenheit. Our problem, therefore, is we have yet to discover a plastic-eating microorganism that produces heat-stable enzymes. Where on our planet would we look for such an organism? You see where I'm going with this, right? Yellowstone hot springs. Hot spring microorganisms have evolved over billions of years to survive under extreme temperature conditions. This means the enzymes they produce are stable at or near the boiling point of water. Now, you might be asking yourself, but why would a hot spring microbe be able to eat plastic? There's none around in its environment. Well, all living organisms need access to the building block of life, carbon. It turns out plants are an easy-to-use carbon source for many microorganisms, including those living in hot springs. Next time you're in the park, take note of all the downed trees, leaves, and pine needles present in the springs. To break down plant material, some species of bacteria and fungi produce an enzyme called cutinase. It helps them gain access to the carbon molecules tied up in that plant biomass. And it turns out this enzyme isn't picky. It's perfectly happy chewing on plants or polymers like plastic. So, I'm a thermal biologist on a treasure hunt, hoping some of Yellowstone's hot spring microorganisms produce heat-stable enzymes that can eat plastic. To start my search, I travel to Yellowstone and collect small volumes of mud from different springs around the park. The mud at the bottom of the springs is where many microbes reside. Out of the thousands of different species present in each spring, I want ones that eat plastic. So I culture my organisms such that plastic is the only carbon source available. In doing this, If any microbe is able to grow, it must survive by eating the plastic. I then look for indicators of microbial growth and material degradation. I often collect microscopic images of the plastic surface, both before and after it's cultured alongside my hot spring microbes. This helps me look for signs of degradation. Degraded plastics form pits and crevasses over time. And sometimes the microbes even burrow into the material as a more effective chewing technique. I also track the consumption and production of different gases, using them as indicators that microbes are growing. If microbes are growing in my culture, they will breathe in oxygen, just like you and me. Thus, in a closed environment, like the ones I create in my laboratory cultures, oxygen levels will decrease. At the same time, one of the byproducts of plastic degradation is carbon dioxide. So, through some additional gas measurements and a little bit of math, I can figure out how much of that plastic material is converted to carbon dioxide. Though my research is still in its early stages, I'm hopeful that Yellowstone Hot Springs and the amazing biodiversity they house can help us develop an effective industry for recycling plastics and reducing waste pollution. Thank you.